Nerdy nocą.
Ale jest dzień.
Gra obowiązują inne standardy niż nas wszystkich.
Nerdy nocą?
Nie jest takie złe.
Nerdy nocą.
W miarę przyzwoite.
Nerdy nocą.
So he's Tomasz Marcinkowski from the PPA, Polish Amiga Portal and Museum of Computers. And we have Mr. Mike Montgomery and Mr. John Eyre. So we have a little interview. And please introduce yourself.
Hi guys, I'm Mike. I'm about to be interviewed by Thomas from the Museum of Computers. Very good.
Hi, my name's John. I used to run Sensible Software with my friend before we sold it a long time ago. I'm also about to be interviewed by Thomas.
The first question is, how did you start with computers and how did you start the game companies?
Okay, so myself and my friend Chris were friends at school, and we were playing in a band together. We were both unemployed, actually, when we were about 19, and my friend taught himself to program and got a job at a local games company, and I was at his house and helped him with some graphics because he couldn't do the art and I could, and then they offered me a job, so we started then working together at the same game company, and we made a game together there. I did several graphics on other games like Firefox and various other things. And then about a year afterwards, we set up Sensible Software on our own because we realized that the other guys were taking 85% of the money and we did all the work.
I was a bit older than John.
You were?
I was, yeah.
Not anymore.
Computer programming was actually my second career. I was a manager for a retail, big retail chain before that. And I stumbled into computers, I stumbled into games even more. I taught myself how to program, not knowing anybody at all that was in the games industry or computer industry, or actually even owned another computer. I decided that the only way I could work out if I was actually doing it right was to apply for a job, which just happens to be with a games company called Leisure Genius. I went for the interview, and while I was there, they offered me the job, and I went, no, I haven't come for a job, I've just come to see how good I am. And, well, cut long story short, within a week, I was working for the games company, and it went from there, really. I worked for them for a couple of years. With my management experience, I became the lead programmer. We got taken on by Virgin Games. I became head of programming, head of development there quite quickly. Had enough of working for a company and decided to work on my own. And then Eric and Steve, my ex-partners, we just got together and started the Bitmap Brothers, and beginning of the history, really.
Okay, and what's the history of the names? So, because the names are quite, innovative for companies. Yes, Sensible Software and Bitmap Brothers, just like Demo Scene.
Myself and Chris could never remember where we came up with the name Sensible Software. I know when we did this game, Twister, which we did in this other company before we set the company up, there's a secret button you can press where you actually get programmed by Sensible Software. It's like a little hidden code. So it would have been that time. That would have been in 1985 we came up with it. We can't remember. I think we were probably a little bit stoned and joking around. But we used to like the fact that it was an S at the start and an E at the end, and both words are eight letters. So we played with this. The initial logo we had was one big S, one big E, and then Ensible and Oftwar between them. And we also did, because we wanted to play on the combination of technology and art, we did one typeface in like some kind of like computerized font, which was modern back in those days. And the other one was like some arty kind of old fashioned font. This is the origin of our name. And it kind of has a nice sound, you know?
Yeah, and you certainly weren't sensible. Sorry about that. Bitmap Brothers, that was a very strange one. It came from one of my ex-partners. We went through a lot of different names, and then one day he phoned up and he said, what about the Bitmap Brothers? Because Bitmap is what we do, is the art. We're very art-led, and Brothers is because we're not brothers, but we're starting almost a corporate, like a co-op type thing, and so you can sort of brothers. And then we put the on because it sounded a bit posh, or a bit posher. It actually did finish it off, and I remember me and Steve Kelly, the other partner, and we both went, that is really shit. And then all three of us woke up the next morning and phoned each other and went, actually, we just can't get the name out of our heads. So it must be the right name. And that's where it was. Where the hand of the logo came from, I can't remember, actually. It's an extremely hard logo to do anything with. So in some respects, it really stands out. But it also represents bitmap art again. So I think it was a combination of both of those.
Great. Okay, so you say you started in the early 80s, yeah? So what machines have you been programming on that time?
Okay, just one thing I noticed about our names first. Sensible Software, Bitmap Brothers, Graft Gold as well. It's all like basic alliteration, you know? That's why they sound nice, I think. They kind of, they ring, you know, starting with B's and S's and stuff. I never programmed, Chris programmed, I did all the art, and we designed between us, we shared the design. But we started off with Sensible Software. Well, the first game Chris did was on ZX 81, which is in black and white, obviously, and then the Spectrum came out around about the time we were starting to do stuff. So Spectrum was our first machine. And then we moved to Commodore 64, and then, you know, you got other versions, so you'd have like an Amstrad version coming out, and, you know, sometimes we did them internally, sometimes we didn't. We tended to focus internally on, yeah, we started off on the Spectrum, but this was only for one game, and then Commodore 64, and then Amiga ST and Mega Drive, because it was all on the same kind of 68,000. And that was it, really. They were our main formats. And then towards the end, we did a little bit. Chris did some stuff on the SNES as well. So they were the formats we did, and the rest were actually done outside of house. We contracted them out. So PC and stuff.
Yeah, for me, actually, I started on the C64, the VIC-20, the PET, the Amstrad, Spectrum, QL. I did a bit of work on the QL. Sinclair QL, MSX, virtually all the 8-bit machines. In fact, in my whole career, I've probably written for every single format that's been out, apart from one or two of the Nintendos. I personally haven't done anything on the Game Boy or the DS, even though some of our products have come out on it. It's not me that's actually programmed. So I've done virtually everything, except for I haven't done the Xbox One or the PlayStation 4, but that will come this year, I'm sure. So, yeah, so it's I've really done everything.
There's a lot of bad formats, wasn't there?
There was
3DO, CD32, remember all those?
We did all those.
CDI.
Yeah. CDI, yeah. But we did all those as well. So,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah. But, you know, as the Bitmap Brothers, we actually started and on the... We didn't do any 8-bit stuff at all. All the 8-bit stuff was done by other people. It was all ST and Amigas.
Right, as we are with the Amigas, tell me, what was your first impression when you first saw the Amigas and its capabilities at that time? And what year was it?
The first game we did on the Amiga was International 3D Tennis, which was our crossover product. So we actually, because it was a 3D game, it's technical obviously, we did it on the Commodore 64 first. Chris did it on the Commodore 64, Chris Yates, and then a guy called Dave Korn, or Ubik is his nickname, he did the Amiga version for us. That's the first time we saw it. But the first game we actually wrote, and we started it almost at this time, was Megalomania. That's the first game we wrote for the Amiga specifically. And I think we'd have started it in 1990, I think. This would be the year, 89 or 90. Well, from Sensible's perspective, actually, on both machines, on Commodore 64, we actually kept on going because we were maybe a top developer on Commodore 64 at the end. And the same with the Amiga, we stayed also there because we were the top developer on the Amiga maybe in Europe at that time. So,
apart from the Bitmap Brothers, of course.
But we stayed later than a lot of people did, which eventually bit us, you know, in the tail when we couldn't do 3D all those years later. But we were really riding a high wave. There was a few of us, like the name companies, and our two companies were two of those. So the first impression of the Amiga was, wow, I can do some proper graphics now. That's the main thing, not those blocky pixels with colour, you know, trying to make everything out of bricks. It was a bit strange.
For me, it was a bit different because I'm not an artist. So the first impressions of the Amiga was, wow, I can get rid of the operating system in the four instructions. Secondly, what the hell is a copper list? And then when I worked out what a copper list and how exciting it was to actually do it, and also how exciting a low level, because I was a low level programmer, that the Amiga was, because you could, by knocking out the operating system with the copper list and the sound chip, you could virtually do whatever you wanted. And I spent, well, I think nearly every Amiga game, and probably ST game actually, thinking about it, is that I was the guy that did all the low-level stuff, all the graphics, all the sound programming and stuff like that. And I think it's because it, what I loved about the machines, both of them, is that it just allowed you to actually do whatever you wanted, and there was no constraints. What? Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm too old to remember that one. I can't actually remember. Not, I don't know.
But you said you never did all the 8-bit stuff internally, so you must have started on Amiga internally, right?
It was a bit more of those, yeah.
Yeah, and when did you start with Bitmap Brothers?
I can't remember. I really can't. I can't remember. It must be in some history book somewhere. Please look it up.
We're here at the Pixel Heaven. How do you find yourself looking at all those people, all those retro geeks, and really loving your old games? It's a long story and it's a history actually, and you see many young people just playing your games.
I think what's interesting, because we do quite a few of these retro events in different places. In England, there's some in Scandinavia as well, in different places here. But here is a really good atmosphere. People feel excited to see the stuff still. There's lots of families here. People bring their kids to show their kids the old games, which is nice. And from our perspective, it's just nice that people remember what we did, and not just what me and Mike did, but what everyone else did at the time and all the other, you know, the history, and that they really care about it. And there's a, you know, there's a passion for these old games in this country, which is really, really nice. It's been a great show, actually. I'm very impressed.
I totally agree with what John says there completely. But I think what we have to remember is about these retro shows is that it is history, and it's a history, part of history that can very easily be forgotten if it wasn't for events like this. And, you know, I thank all the organisers, you know, for keeping that going, because, you know, we work in one of the biggest industries in the world now. I mean, it's still one of the biggest growth industries in the world. And, you know, when we started it was virtually nothing. It was, you know, people were working in their bedrooms, you know, and bedrooms in their garages. You know, me and John probably worked for two of the most fastest growing development companies at the time, probably as well. But we were only part of that history. I mean, there's a whole load of games before the 16-bit. You know, we're famous for the 16-bit. I know we've done 8-bit. Well, John's famous for quite a few 8-bit ones as well, not so much me. But it's the whole thing. It's the whole retro scene, if you like, that did it. And this is what these shows are about. It's the history up until the Amiga was finished. And, you know, then after that, then it becomes... I think the whole industry became a lot more commercialised at that point, and a huge business. You know, you can imagine with Xenon 1, you know, we got an advance of £25,000 and made a profit. That doesn't even pay for 5 seconds of some of these big corporation games now. You know, so just let's remember where the roots came from.
We have written here on the cards that the Amiga was the last computer with a soul. I think it's what you said, that
it was the last home computer that you can play games on that was sold. Actually, the QL did. It was probably the last one. But the QL didn't get anywhere, sadly, because actually the QL was a great machine. But yeah, it was the last.
I think what was special about the Amiga, and for me it's the best machine we've ever worked on, for me it's the best era, was that it was a great machine for the time technologically. So there's lots of stuff we could do loads of new exciting stuff. People were making different types of game, new genres of game were coming out all the time, which was fantastic. It was a free platform, so anyone could use it. And also the publishing wise, there was freedom for publishing. So even though now we've got some platforms, like the iPhone, for example, is still quite controlled. You know, it's still controlled by Apple, really. And then we had a long console era, which was totally controlled and gatekept by Sony, Nintendo, and other companies. So that period of the Amiga was special because it was a tool given to us as artists to make art without anyone stopping us or controlling us and stuff. That's why it was a special time. But there's no reason why, you know, and the PC has always had this capability, but technologically, it's just such a mess that there's always been other problems associated with the PC. So the good thing about the Amiga was also it was quite a controlled, for a good programmer, it was a really controlled environment. And it was stable, you know? So even nowadays, when you make games on modern machines, there's so much technology that you need to hook into that you can interface with, hooking into Facebook, hooking into something online, you know, different screen sizes of stuff on Android, for example. And these all impact on how much you can control what you're making. So this was a perfect controlled environment and free platform. That's what was so great about it.
I would say that Commodore actually didn't know what to do with the Amiga in the beginning, so they were not aware of what capabilities it has.
I think the main thing with the Amiga is it wasn't very successful in America. This is the main reason that the Commodore story kind of tailed off. It didn't really, if you look at most of the games that, you know, the great games that were made, and most of the fans are from Europe. Just look around. You won't see many Amiga shows in the States like this, for example. So I think that's the reason it went. It was very sad when Commodore went, and a few of us, did you go to some of those meetings, Mike, when Commodore was falling apart?
We were involved with Commodore or doing something, I know, at the time, and that we were about to sign a big deal, a software deal with them, but it just, the problem is it just went pop extremely quickly. I mean, so much so, it probably was only about 2 weeks, you know. And it was such a shame. It was just like, and of course, you know, for us, for Sensible and for quite a few other English developers, it could have been the total end of games.
Maybe people don't understand this. When we were in that time, 1994, 95, towards the end of the Amiga, and people often say, why did you abandon the Amiga? Why did you move? I can tell you why. For a start, everyone wanted 3D in games at that time. So all the 2D games we'd made, we couldn't sell. And the amount of money we were offered 4 times more money to work on PC or on console than on Amiga. So this combination of these two things, the market totally lost, all the publishers totally lost support for the machine. And this is probably what hastened this, just total quick collapse, as Mike said. It was a bit of an avalanche.
The Commodore's death and introduction of Pentiums, yes, and introduction of 3DFX, Voodoo graphic cards. It was all at the same time, so I think it's the nail, yes, to the coffin, so, right. Maybe I could ask you, what of your game you like the most? Which of your games?
Same, which games do I like of my games, Bitmap Brothers games, the most? Okay. Canva, programming-wise, was my favourite game that I worked on because it was in isometric 3D. I was the low-level programmer, so therefore I did some of the physics and some of all the graphic programming, which was quite a challenge because I'm not 3D orientated at all. Funny enough, after the Amiga, my low-level programming was reduced quite dramatically, even though I've still done a lot, actually, but not graphics. And the other one, Zed, because, you know, in fact, I became the lead programmer on it and I finished it. It was a great product. And Steel Soldiers, because I half-designed after my partner left with another designer, and it was just great fun doing the design on that, yeah. So I have more than one.
Yeah, I'm the same as Mike. I've got more than one. It's really hard. It's like asking someone who their favourite child is, you know? Because these are like our babies. And it's, you know, it's hard to pick. I mean, the most important game is Sensible World of Soccer. You know, for us, it was our most successful game. It sold the most. It's obviously a good game. It got voted onto some Stanford University most 10 influential games of all time list about a few years ago. So in terms of credibility, you know, it was the only game in Europe they voted for, the European game. So it was a big deal for us. So definitely most proud of that. And the fact that we took a game to the world, so we added like countries like Poland or the old Yugoslavia or Argentina or South Africa. We were putting football teams in, genuine statistics about your country when no one else was doing this. So socially, I'm proud of that. I'm also, you know, my favorite sensible game is WizKid. It's the most sensible game is actually WizKid because it's so crazy, and it's the last game me and Chris did together, and it kind of, it captures the atmosphere of our working relationship the best because of how that was. But there's lots of other games I like. I'm very proud of Megalomania. I think it's a really good game, and I think it was very innovative. Whizball, of course, and Cannon Fodder as well. All of these games in different ways. It's really, really hard to pick, you know?
Actually, I've got another favourite game, which isn't, funny enough, actually isn't a Bitmap Brothers game. It's not a sensible game. It was actually a Tower Studios game. I think that was actually doing Rugby Sevens.
Oh, that was fun.
That was fun. Yeah, especially as we sent John away on holiday for a fortnight so we could finish it. And then he came back and we spent, I think it was three whole days without any sleep finishing it around my house. That was the first time I probably really worked with John. And probably the only time development-wise I've actually worked, and it was
the soccer conversion.
That was great fun. That was on the mobile platform, the old mobile platform with the Nokias and the Siemens and all those crappy phones.
Yeah, actually, I've got to say, I agree with Mike. That's a fantastic time because we set Tower up. And we did Cannon Fodder and Sensi Soccer conversions, but then we did rugby. And Sensible, we always wanted to do, like, you know, we did golf, Sensible Golf. We also always wanted to do, like, cricket, rugby, other games. So this was the most, this was, like, sensible rugby that never happened at the time, which was fantastic. And we also designed this game at the time called Monster Mini Golf, which I really enjoyed designing. But a guy we got to program it was just, it was terrible, wasn't it? Do you remember?
Yeah.
So there's so many games that certainly that we made that never came out, like Sex, Drugs and Rock and Roll and Console Olympics and The Day the Universe Died, all these names. And then I've lots of games. And this Monster Mini Golf was another one in that line. I like that game. I've got a soft spot for it.
I want to ask you about the music, of course, you made for, especially for the Cannon Fodder. Tell me the story behind the Lost in Service music and the title music.
So the Lost in Service music was actually a love song I wrote when I was about 18, when I split up with my girlfriend and I was very depressed because she went off with my best friend.
Wow.
One of these sob stories. So I wrote this song. Actually, myself and Chris performed it in a gig one time when we were pretty crazy and we were both wearing rubber masks and Chris was wearing a dress and I was wearing a dressing gown, and it was a crazy gig, and I play this love song, and in the middle of it, it's quite a sensitive song, Chris came in blasting his lead guitar really loud, like twice as loud as me, and to take the piss out of me actually, and then he went running across the stage, and then the lead came out his guitar and it suddenly stopped. But this song was an old love song, and then I got it going again with a band years later and added stuff like bass and drums and the kind of arrangement and the bit of sax part. And then when we did Cannon Fodder, we had the scene, you know, the stuff when the names are going up and everyone's dead and we needed some music. So I went to see Richard Joseph and I took the song and he just basically converted it to an amazing, you know, Amiga piece. And then actually there's another version that people have heard with vocals and saxophone. So we recorded that then at the same time, like a really good version as a promotional thing. Virgin actually paid for the recording studio, which is fantastic. And the sax player on it is a guy who plays with Roger Waters from Pink Floyd as well, because my friend got him in for 50 quid. For 50 quid. It's amazing. And amazing sax. Best 50 quid I ever spent, actually. And the war song, I just came up with this little, pretty much as I played yesterday at this concert, just some guitar chords and War's Never Been So Much for Melody and a bass line. And with these things, I went to Richard's house. I used to go there about once a week. It's my favorite bit of the week, actually. And we would just make music. And he just is an arrangement genius. I mean, Mike worked with him many times. He's just turned everything he touched seemed to turn to gold. And he just turned it into a great classic arrangement of a song, which is now our most famous game song, which is great.
Right, and we can also hear the version from the CD32 movie and all the story behind the movie. It's completely crazy and funny. So,
and this is why they call him Sensible Software. Sensible Software, I'm sorry.
Well, at that time, all those hit games we had, when we had like Cannon Fodder, Sensible Soccer, Megalomania, WizKid, this little period where there were six people in the office. So it's myself and Chris Yates, Chris Chapman, who's a lead programmer on Sensible Soccer and SWOS and Megalomania, Jules Jameson, who was a lead programmer on Cannon Fodder and Sensible Golf, Stu Cambridge, who Cannon Fodder was the first game I didn't do the art for, but Stu did all that kind of art really pretty much after then. It was Stu who did the art. And Dave Korn, who kind of did bits of programming on different things. He did some stuff on Sensible Soccer, did some stuff on 3D Tennis Conversion, he did bits and bobs. And this six-man team was the core. And then we had Richard Joseph, who did all our music, and another guy who did a lot of football data called Mike Hammond, who's great as well. So we just decided to make a video. I remember, again, it's following up from kind of this thing about self-promotion. And as we said yesterday in an interview, you know, the Bitmap started this idea of the rock star thing. And we kind of picked up and we had the music and we decided we'd make a video. So I remember writing out on a sheet of paper every bar and saying, right, on this bar, we're going to have someone running along and shooting somebody. And then in this bar, we're going to have someone crying over a photo of a goat in stockings and blah, 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 blah. And then we had to go about doing the production on it. So we found a field locally that belonged to an old lady with poppies in it. And we knocked on the door and we were very polite and she let us use her field for the day, which was great. And we found a guy who drove a half track. We rented him. That cost 80 quid for the day. I remember these prices. And it came with the drive around the half track, which was brilliant. And then we found a local company that did military uniforms and hired them out. So we hired them out. And then we did bought some stupid guns. And then we got a guy to do the editing. And we used a cameraman from a local news team that had done an interview with us a couple of years before in Anglia News, where we live. And the whole thing cost £800 to make that video. And it was really like a day out. For the guys, it was just a day out. Like for a day, we were like pretending we were a band, like I guess like a Madness kind of band at the time. We would have been of those kind of bands. That was the kind of feeling of it. Or Monty Python maybe. Yeah. but look, I mean, people watching it today. So again, sometimes it works, you know.
I'm sorry, I do laugh about this because I think it's one of the funniest things I've ever seen, and it is really good. But it's like, why do you call yourself Sensible Software? I'm sorry, I'm taking the mickey out of John.
Yeah, officially we can change the name to Funny Software. Yes. Any funny story behind the Bitmap Brothers?
I think the Bitmap Brothers were a slightly... Sensible Soccer was the humorous part of the industry, and I think the Bitmap Brothers were probably a little bit more serious, which is a shame, really. I mean, there are some... We have done some mad things, but we've mainly kept them to ourselves, I think. You know, I've been involved with many drinking sessions that I wouldn't like. Like doing an impersonation of, was it impersonation of a windmill down in Kensington and High Street, and with a nice policeman that came over to me and said, "Sir, would you like to come to the police station for a cup of coffee?" And I said, "No." He says, "I think you better come to the police station for a cup of coffee because you're causing a nuisance." I managed not to get arrested that time. I've managed not to get arrested any time, but I've been very close. I think we're doing just mad things like that. I mean, that was a day that we were just finishing Gods, and I think it was Gods, and I'd just done 5 days without sleep, and then we went to this awards, and it was quite funny because the awards were for the Golden Joystick, and it was in Kensington High Street, and it was the top of a building in Kensington High Street, which has a garden at the top. But not only has it a garden, but it has pink flamingos in a pond, and it's like, you can imagine, I haven't slept for four or five days. I've had a few beers, a little bit tipsy. Walk out onto the balcony and see a pink flamingo. I tell you what, I've never done drugs, but that must have been the closest I've ever had for hallucinating. But the problem is, it was actually real.
I just want to add something. You know, when Mike says he did 4 or 5 days without sleep, he means no sleep. You know, I know a lot of people talk about this, but, you know, the days people talk about crunch now, and sometimes they say they're crunch because instead of working 8 hours in the office, they worked 11. We are talking about back-to-back 4 or 5 days, and I've seen him do it. He's got the most stamina I've seen of any games programmer, but a lot of people, like we'd have some guys, we'd do 3 days back-to-back without sleeping, and you do hallucinate. Your eyes just give up working properly. I remember driving home once after one of these. I think it was like even one day without sleeping. You don't know what you're looking at sometimes. It's really dangerous, actually, to do this. But I don't think maybe people realise how much those games were our life when we made them. They just became your life, you know?
It was extremely hard on our families because we just weren't there a lot of the time. We were just like so engrossed, so engrossed in doing the programming, doing all the design, doing all the testing that it's almost like you didn't have a life, but you had a great life because it was the games was your life. And I think that's how dedicated we were. And I think that also proves how good our games are because that's how much love and care that we actually put into it over our families sometimes.
I've got a little thing to sum this up. When we were finishing off SWOS, Chris Chapman, the lead programmer, he did like a whole week in the office. Like, that was it. Like, virtually no sleep. What are those things called? Pro Plus?
Oh, yeah.
Things that all the programmers used to stay awake. And he was there so much, his wife came round to the office to make sure he was actually at work. And that's really what it was like, because you just got absorbed into this world of finishing something, you know? And I guess in the demo scene people do this as well, but when you've got the commercial pressures of testing stuff and you've got publishers sitting there waiting for you to finish stuff, you just have to throw yourself into it. I think that maybe a lot of people now want to start out. If they start to think like this, it's not a bad attitude to have, to just make it become your life for a while, you know? And also in those days, we didn't have internet or mobile phones interrupting us every 30 minutes, which has made a massive difference to work culture in everything, not just in games. We could just focus and obsess for a whole week with no break, which was great. I loved that time, actually. I love working like that.
The last word. What would you say to the Amigas and Amigans and other gamers here and on our portal?
Thank you. Thank you for all of the support that, you know, you've had over the years. And thanking you for being part of the history as well that we are a part of.
I agree with Mike. Thank you for supporting us and making our lives so great in our work, because it's all from the fans that this has come, you know. And I'd also say, when you're looking now at the games people are making now, to understand the spirit we were working on. A lot of people, they talk about retro, they go, yeah, why don't you remake Cannon Fodder on the iPhone or whatever it might be, or Sensible Soccer on the whatever it might be. The point is, in those days, we just made a new great game because we were passionate about it. What the retro was a spirit of creativity. And actually making remakes isn't that spirit. So to understand that was a spirit and to support younger guys, because me and Mike are a bit long in the tooth now, who have that same spirit is what's important to me, because that's where the new retro scene is going to come from. Younger guys, not us. You know, we're the past. It's great. We love that. But we need a new future of this kind of spirit so we can have another retro scene in another, you know, like 20 years time.
Thank you for the interview. And let's come back and party.
Następny odcinek niebawem. Powiadomienia o nowych odcinkach będą na stronie nerdynocą.pl.